So why do limits and rationing, why do they matter? Well, one reason is obviously that healthcare is getting more and more expensive. And if we don't find ways, as we've been very bad at in the US, if we don't find ways to limit expenditure, we lose access. The US, I have a strong personal feeling visiting Singapore or visiting other countries. There's some wonderful things in the US healthcare system, but it's really not something I'm proud of. I mean, we have almost 10 times your population uninsured because we have not limited costs. So first reason is obvious. I don't know if this would have bearing in Singapore, but in the US, there's been a great deal of discussion. Is it ethical to think of limiting healthcare costs? And I've made the opposite argument. It's unethical not to pay attention to costs, because by not paying attention to costs, there'll be very bad harms done. Second reason, is, as I thought of it in our own location, is for societal learning. That in dealing with limits, it's a source of wisdom, of recognizing truths about life, that the possibilities are finite. There are wonderful possibilities, but they're limited. And finally, again, this I think I know is very true in the US. I don't know its application here. But when it's clear that the alternative to becoming more efficient is rationing and setting stern limits, that helps motivate us to become more efficient. I don't know how much this applies here. It definitely applies at home, where habits can become expensive. So there's an old joke. Limits are seen differently in different cultures. So in India, death, which is the ultimate limit, can be the source of ultimately moving away from reincarnation towards nirvana. And in Europe, in France, with the existentialists, it's a tragedy that we all must face. In the US, death is optional, seen as optional. It's not literally seen as optional. That's a good joke about my own. So this is my effort, really based on the reading I did before I came, to compare the contexts for resource allocation in the US and Singapore. And by a nice coincidence, the year you became independent is the year our largest insurance program, Medicare for the elderly, and Medicaid for the poor were passed. So 1965, the US was wealthy and secure. And my impression is when you became independent, I don't think anyone here is old enough to have been paying. Well, I won't ask who's alerted and independence. But a poor and vulnerable country, you began to build your health system. We launched these large programs that did not have limits attached. Our Medicare program for the elderly, the legislation prevents the Medicare program from taking costs into account. The law says individuals should get any treatment that is reasonable, and I forget what the second word is, but it's a very open ending. Where are we? You have control spending, you're thinking of doubling what you're spending. We're way out of control for costs. So the work that, the book that JJ had, that I did, it's work I did with a philosopher, colleague, and friend. It started from two questions, which are really like questions the ethics committees have to deal with. Why should an individual or a family who think that a treatment is the right thing to do, We have a phrase in U.S. insurance of medical necessity. If they think a treatment is medically necessary, why in the world should they accept as fair a decision that that treatment won't be provided? And why should they accept as legitimate that someone has made this, some person or body or organization has made this decision? And I know just from the conversations I've had before we started that these are interactions you have with families who say, we want this treatment to continue even though the staff has concluded it has no further benefit to offer. The way we did this work was a combination of intellectual analysis but field work. And I realized I think we used, without knowing it, a very Singaporean methodology, because one thing that, that Singapore has done from early on is gone, if you think something's being done well elsewhere, you go and look at it and see what can I learn from it. And in a way, that's what my colleague and I did. We identified places where resource allocation, as best we could tell, was being done very well. And we went and observed and asked, how do you do what you do? Why do you do it? We did that, but we did none of that in Asia. It was in the US, in Canada, in England, the National Health Service, and a little bit in some of the European countries, but primarily those three sites. So basic question is, obviously we need to allocate resources, we need to set limits, but how can we do it? And what we concluded, my colleague and I, is that especially in pluralistic societies with multiple ethical perspectives, we don't have a set of principles that tells us this is the right answer, the way we can do that in mathematics. We don't have to debate, is this a solution to a problem? Evidence is obviously important. And I don't know if this happens for you in Singapore, but it's common for us in the States that there'll be debate about the evidence. How good is the evidence? So the dominant, a randomized controlled trial shows this, but the family says, our neighbor had that treatment, and I see you're smiling. Have you encountered that?
Yeah.
So our neighbor had it. That's evidence. He had it, and he got better. So evidence is obviously important, but there's not a shared gold standard as to what the definitive right evidence is. Cost effectiveness is also very important, but whose values do we go by? If I'm a sick person, I think this $1 million treatment is very cost effective because I want to get well. I don't think it's cost effective for my neighbor because it's just too much. And the market values, markets are very important, but they leave people out. So the conclusion we have, and this is the core of our approach, all of these four are important, but societies need a fair process to set limits. There's not a simple engineering kind of solution. So this is the gist, the summary of what we concluded from observation. And I'm very interested presenting this here, because as I said, the observations and the people who did the work are from Western liberal democracies. And the degree of relevance and usefulness in another culture, I think, remains to be seen. But the gist of the view is that for the set, a fair process for setting limits has to meet four conditions. The first is relevant reasons. the limit in this case or in this policy is based on relevant reasons, clinical evidence, what individuals need, but also what a population needs. So it's evidence about individuals and about the larger group that the individual is part of. The second point of publicity, again, these are very strong values, strongest in the US, also in Canada and the UK, but the US is very strong about public access, transparency. The policies and rationales should be public. That people are not going to trust and see as legitimate and go along with limits that are in a black box. And the third broad area is that they should be revisable. And this, actually, one of the things I did to prepare for coming here was to read Lee Kuan Yew's Singapore 1965 to 2000. And he emphasized this is a pragmatic society. Try it and fix it. And revisability is consistent with that. No policy, however wise it seems, is guaranteed to be perfect. Individuals need the right and an avenue for making appeals, and a group that thinks a policy is wrong should be able to challenge the policy itself. And the fourth condition is that these first three should be enforceable, not just pie in the sky. I think you all have the slides, so I'm going to go through these a little bit more quickly, because just in the interest of allocating the resource of time. For the relevance condition, what does that mean? Well, these are practical tests, and I actually, looking at it this morning, I realized I assumed and left off a bullet or two, so I'll add to it. But how would we judge whether the relevance condition has been met? Well, I put first, have the decision makers acknowledge the needs and wishes of the patients and family. Now again, I don't know if this applies here, but something I saw in the States, I saw a lot, particularly in my field. I'm a psychiatrist, and psychiatry historically in the States has had more limits than other areas of medicine. And I saw a tendency when a limit was involved, I don't want to put this too strongly, but to act as if the patient didn't need whatever this was, that it wasn't going to be helpful to the person, or not to really come to grips with the fact that the person wanted it. And part of relevance is being honest about what people want. We may think what they want is all wrong, but they want it, so that's the starting point. What we do then calls for communication skill. And do we gather pertinent evidence? The rest is fairly clear. What I didn't put in as a bullet, because I presuppose it, is that, and this is an area where we're weak in the US, have we taken population needs, the needs of the group and the resources available for the group into account? Publicity, the publicness. Again, these particular details are derived from observations in the US, Canada, and the UK. Public hearings, wide consultation, giving the rationale, the reasoning to the public, making it very, not waiting for WikiLeaks to come along and expose what's happened, but sharing that in an interactive way with the public. Revisability. I really spoke about that. At the individual level, I've had this exchange with patients of my own, where I said what I was prepared care to allocate, and they disagreed, and we couldn't come to an agreement. I told them how they could appeal. You know, here's the name of the telephone number of someone who can undo what I've said, but this is what my conclusion is, and here's why. And then finally, the enforcement conditions, that these ingredients should be seen as expectations, that this is overall the right way to carry out our process. Now, this little diagram has been quite helpful to us in teaching. So, see if it's useful for you. The basic idea is that in a hospital like this, or a clinic, or a society, we want, ideally, everyone to endorse and feel in their hearts two values. One we put as fidelity to the needs of the individual. The basic healthcare value. But in the US especially, we're weak on this. When we were developing this diagram, I was looking for a term that had religious connotations. And we came up with stewardship of shared resources. So these are both values bearing on the individual, bearing on the community, that I think people can feel good about their basic human values. But the point here is, at the front line where the patients are, where we're taking care of individuals, in the exam room, we want this to predominate. That's our responsibility. We're primarily dealing with the patients, but we should be aware as well that there's a population with its own needs. Again, in my country, it's been slow. I've taken a lot of criticism. When I first started to talk about this topic, I don't know, 30 years ago, people said, "Oh, you sound like a Chinese communist." In the US, that was not a term of praise. And in the boardroom, or the head of the hospital, the Ministry of Health, we want the population focus to predominate because that's the responsibility. But we want the people who are at that level to be aware that every decision they make is affecting an individual. So ideally. And this is not something that's solved once for always, but requires work. We want as wide as possible an endorsement. And it's not so much an intellectual exercise. It's a personal attitude. We all know people who are very selfish, they don't think of others, at least I know plenty. And vice versa, people who don't think of themselves. So, I don't know about children growing up in Singapore, but it occurred to me some time back that in a psychological sense, what we're talking about here is sharing. So how do children learn to share? Well, I don't know how Singaporean children learn to share. Maybe it comes naturally to them. It does not come naturally to children in the US. So there's, when you think of it, there's a cognitive side. Johnny, let Susan have a turn with the toy. So I see your, okay, so I guess that happens here too. You're explaining a simple term. That's fair. You've been playing with it, and now it's her turn to play with it. That's cognitive. And emotionally, when he throws himself on the floor and starts to scream and kick, that's, you try to help him soothe himself. And after 10 or 100 tantrums, learn to share. So it has a cognitive element, but it's not an intellectual process. It's something that's learned through repetition and guidance. I think the same is true for societies. And that's what makes for interesting cultural difference. I'm pretty sure that your society has had different experiences than mine. We're at the level of policy, we are not strong on the sharing side. Another way that I use to think about this is the metaphor of fractions, the numerator and the denominator. And in order for people to understand and potentially see limits as fair, they need a sense of my needs, my wishes, my family's needs and wishes, but we're part of a larger population. We're not the only people in the world. And similarly, the funds that are available, and really this is actually quite an interesting contrast, which I'll show on the other slide, between having to in Singapore. With the funds that are available, we could always do more in healthcare and have fewer limits, but what would that mean for the total society? I feel this very personally at home. We have extremely high healthcare costs. One of my sons is the principal of a K-8 school in a poor section of Boston. His teachers don't earn as much money as they should. It's such a contrast, the healthcare. So I see healthcare in this personal sense as robbing other areas that contribute to human well-being in very important ways. An interesting fact about Singapore in terms of overall resources is that when you became independent, there was really a crash program to build a society. And you invested in the social and environmental contributors to health quite heavily. Building the economy, building education, clean water and adequate water, public safety. All of those have major health implications. So you didn't pin as much of human well-being, including health, on health care, certainly in our society, in the U.S. I think that was good. So here's an example that I think we all have a lot to learn from. In the National Health Service in the U.K., how many people have experience in the NHS? I know we have one person from the U.K. I have no direct experience, though I've made observations. You can say if I'm saying falsehoods.
Well, just to say that there are more countries than England or Wales in the United Kingdom, but we'll let you off with just mentioning England and Wales. Scotland doesn't have the same problems.
No, that's true.
It's all right, Jeff. I know it's a different health department, that's why.
I did put down the
There's no confusion the UK with England.
I apologize for that. correct. Actually, I didn't even put it on the slide. It came out of my mouth. So I apologize. In the system where so the population of England and Wales must be 40 million, 45 million. It's large, but conceptually, if I'm living there, I can understand the numerator and the denominator. The denominator is all the other people who live in this particular area, so it's easy to understand. And if I am indignant about how our health system is working, I can say, who's to blame for this? Well, ultimately, it's me, as part of the electorate and part of a voter. We decide via Parliament, via England and Wales, how much to spend on the health service. And if I think we ought to be spending more, my job is to politic for that. So again, it's not like it's coming from a mysterious place in the sky. It's coming from the ground up in the political process. Now, in setting limits, I've invoked the idea of culture often. Actually, I'm going to read this and talk about it. So this is from the writing of the head of the National Institute for Clinical Excellence, which is a part of the National Health Service that contributes to policy choices and very explicitly to limits. So he makes the point that NICE, they're qualified, they're well qualified to make scientific judgments. And they are, they do a great job with that, with assessing new technologies. But he says, we have no special legitimacy to impose our own social values on England and Wales and the National Health Service and its patients. And those, he says, and I agree with this, should broadly reflect the values of the population who use the service and pay for it. And to recognize that, you know, how do you operationalize that? It's nice to say that as a principle. I mean, it's sort of like saying a political speech. They created citizens' councils, the Citizens' Council, to provide advice. It's not decision making. And the basic mechanism, do you have any experience of this in the UK, or you've just read about it as I have? I've talked to people, I've never been in the council meeting, I've talked to people who facilitate. And the basic idea is, it's not a haphazard group. They put a group together designed to reflect the demography of England and Wales. So people from Scotland are out, but from England and Wales, for the age and ethnic distribution and income distribution. And people are on it for 3 years, so there's a kind of learning process. I think they have 2 or 3 meetings a year for 3 days at a time. And they deal with major issues like, should we take age into account? Or how should we deal with rare diseases for which there are super expensive treatments? And they have a well-facilitated discussion with, if you're interested in this, you can read the reports on the web. So it's quite a public process. So I'm going to just talk about some of their principles, because I think we all have a lot to learn from this. I think this is an elegant social process. So I'm a big fan of the structure that you've created. So principle one, evidence. If there's not good evidence, we shouldn't be paying for something. But, as he said, if there's a new treatment, it's promising, but it's not established, we might recommend, we might endorse it if it's carried out within a research program. Now, we have a prime example from the US of not doing this. Maybe 15 or 20 years ago, there was a powerful advocacy process for bone marrow transplant for women with advanced breast cancer. And there was a theoretical rationale and some impressionistic evidence that maybe this would help. And of course, there's a strong constituency for this because it's often younger women and it's such a common condition. So in many places, it became, through a political process, required that this be covered. And then ultimately, it turned out that it was not an effective treatment, and probably a good number of people were harmed by that, and their lives were made worse. So we were doing that not within a research program, and it's harder to research cost effectiveness. It seems like a no-brainer that this should be thought about. But as I said before, in the US, our Medicare program, by legislation, hasn't yet allowed cost-effective reasoning, which, as a psychiatrist, I would say, I think is a form of political insanity. I won't dwell in detail, but they say NICE should consider factors like distributing resources fairly if there have been groups that have been discriminated against or have had particularly poor access for other reasons. Transparency, it should explain its reasoning. It's sort of like what I said before, societies have to learn about limits the way we do as children. That's what this fifth principle is. Individual users will expect to receive the treatments, but NICE doesn't have to recommend and shouldn't recommend things that aren't effective or cost effective, and there should be some form of advisability. So, just backing up on this, how does it decide about setting limits fairly? Well, in the 1980s and 1990s, in Britain, they decided, in England and Wales, they decided that implicit rationing that didn't own up to what it was doing, and there had been work on that in studying the NHS that showed that in areas like kidney dialysis, physicians were saying to their patients, someone who's 65, dialysis doesn't work for someone your age, which actually isn't true. So that was implicit rationing. They decided that implicit rationing was no longer an acceptable approach. Now this is an interesting point, and I don't know what the view, what the dominant views would be here in Singapore. My own sense is that it's no longer possible to ration implicitly for very long, even if one wanted to. With the internet, with expectations of openness, if I'm a patient in an area with implicit rationing, my son is going to go on the web and say, hey, they do this somewhere else. So this was a decision that was made in England. I apologize, I said the UK. So they created a process to foster explicit rationing. And again, it looks to me as if the way that this process was carried out was very Singaporean, very pragmatic. They didn't go up on top of the mountain and say what's the right answer for what the threshold for cost effectiveness should be. They started with specific cases and they struggled with those, and gradually, out of practical decisions, they came up with a range that they applied. I'm going to do this very quickly. In the US, Aetna is a large insurance company. And they recruited someone who I spent some time interviewing, that's why his name is here, in 1991 to head their technology assessment process. Before he got there, Aetna was on the front page of the newspapers and on television. They denied some cancer treatment that they thought was ineffective to someone and it went viral in the way, pre-internet. This person recognized that, the problem here is a problem of trust. And he set up a system. His system was, if we, the insurance company, so this, I suppose, could apply to MedShield, or I don't know as much about the private insurance that happens here. If we think something should be covered, we can say yes. If we think this new treatment isn't effective enough, we don't empower ourselves to say no. We'll send it to an independent evaluator. Why? It's not because they're more competent than we are, but they are not in the same conflict of interest situation. They're not paying for the treatment as we are. So even if we're impeccably honest and accurate, we're going to be trusted less because by saying no, we're saying we don't have to pay for it. So they set up that system, and 5 years later, the state of California made a law putting it into effect for experimental treatments, treatments that were regarded as experimental for serious illnesses. By now, 44 states have put that into effect. So the lesson there, there are a couple of lessons. I think the person at Aetna had a very good insight and designed a system that addressed it, a social mechanism of independent assessment. And over a period of 10 to 15 years, that spread so that there's been an element of societal learning. That's what this slide says. I'll also summarize this because I want to then go to the case. Kaiser Permanente, how many of you have heard of it? It's an organization in the US. Some, but not everyone. Kaiser is an organization that combines a large medical group and the insurance function. So they provide insurance, I think, in California is where it's largest, to about 6 million people there. So in California, Kaiser is kind of like Singapore, all part of the same population size. What I think we can learn from them is about how doctors and nurses and other health professionals can be drawn into this process of thinking about limits. And this is a little example from my own field that, again, I thought was very well carried out. With these, the selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor antidepressants, Prozac, I don't know. Are these the names used here? Prozac, Zoloft, Paxil, Celexa. So, very commonly used, useful, and when they were introduced, pretty pricey, expensive. And in 2001, Prozac became generic. So, there was a study published, this is the author, lead author, in the Journal of the American Medical Association, in the same year, that basically found that Prozac, Paxil, and Zoloft, the three examples in major use then, they seemed equivalent in effectiveness. And there was an editorial written by this person who's a psychiatric researcher, excellent and quite respected in the field. And he said, I completely agree with what he said. On the basis of this kind of evidence, which really squared with a lot of clinical impression, that if you start making a first prescription, if you think that a patient needs a drug from this family, if you're making a first prescription, a choice based on cost is prudent, ethical, and clinically reasonable. So an authoritative member of the field said this, and they started a program that they called fluoxetine, which is the generic version of Prozac first. And they basically educated, it's large, remember they're caring for 6 million people. In the mental health segment, they did a lot of education and with the primary care doctors, because most of the SSRIs are prescribed outside of psychiatry. They did a lot of education around this, and the system they put in, this is what I thought was really smart. They didn't have rules, you've got to do this. So if I'm a psychiatrist there, and I'm going to prescribe for a patient, and the patient says to me, my twin brother took Prozac and dropped dead. That's a perfectly good reason to try something else. So I don't have to go through any red tape. But if I, but the head of my department, we'll just keep an eye on the prescriptions. And if after a year, 80% of my first prescriptions are for Zoloft, my chief would come to me and say, Jim, I see your prescribing pattern. Perhaps you know something we don't know. Would you come to our meeting and tell us? Now, I think that's a very good approach, because if I really did know something, they ought to know about it. And if it's just my preference, not based on evidence, but because when my sister was depressed, Zoloft cured her, and that is the basis of my prescribing, that's not really a good medical reason. So the example, what I think we can learn from them is from this process. Again, it took time, but it involved the prescribers, the doctors, nurse practitioners can prescribe. They couldn't back then, but they can now in the U.S. They involved the doctors and nurses in clinical learning and in attention to the denominator and the numerator. And so it was not enforced by a rule, some outside person cracking the whip. It came from the... Okay. So conclusions, and then let me just... Good. Conclusions, then we'll go to the case. So what can we say about learning about how to deal with limits? Well, to be melodramatic about it, healthcare limits, the topic really rubs our noses into the ultimate limits. That we're all going to die, that all people will die, a disease, so on. And the first impulse of the US, as evidenced by that joke, I do not know the degree to which that's true here, is to avoid the topic and blame the messenger who's talking about limits. When the denominator is easy to understand, it becomes easier to think, yes, I want this for me, for my family, but I'm part of a larger entity, and it's right to think about all of us. Our system in the US is very fragmented. I won't go into the sorry details, but it makes it much harder to have a sense of the denominator, apart from the fact that we're such a large country. I think a relatively small country like Singapore, you have the advantage of being an island, so it's not 3,000 miles from one end to another as it is in the US. I think it's easier for you to have a sense of the denominator as well as the numerator. In the US, it's often common to say things like, life is priceless. And in emotional terms, it is. But when we're thinking about a health system, it's not. for obvious reasons. There's a finite amount of money and a lot of people to take care of. When we ask, again in the US, this studies people, how can we put a price tag on a person's life? I don't know whether it came here, how in the health reform process that President Obama led, there was this term of death panels. If you're talking about limits, that's a death panel. There'll be a government people saying you should die and you don't have to die yet. What exemplifies well is it didn't convene a religious philosophical meeting to put a price tag on a person, and economists put it started with specific decisions and learned from the ground up. And so where I am is I can say with some confidence that what we in this work drew from a set of observations and conceptualized what was happening in good settings that can be accepted and useful as part of a limit setting process, at least in the setting of Western liberal democracies. Whether it's useful elsewhere, I think that remains to be seen.